A very warm welcome to everyone who is just joining us. This panel discussion this evening is the latest in a series of collaborations between the British School at Athens and my old department, the Centre for Hellenic Studies at King's College London. And those of you who've perhaps been following previous events in the series will detect a thread of continuity running through them. The first in 2019 focused on literary translation. The second last year was about migration, the migration that is of people, migration and refugees. And now, in the anniversary year of the 1821 revolution, we're moving the agenda along the same kind of lines, in looking this time at the migration, not of people, but of ideas. And because 1821, the 2021 anniversary is a special occasion, we're having not one panel discussion, but two. So this evening's presentation, which is based in Athens, though I personally am some 2,000 miles away, was meant to happen in Athens, and it goes back to back with a similar event at a different time, 6 p.m. in UK, 8 p.m. in Greece, next Monday, when a panel based in the UK will address the same theme, but I'm sure in intriguingly different ways. So the theme for this evening, and indeed for next Monday, is the migration of revolutionary ideas. And what we're thinking about here, because after all, let's remember that in real time in 1821, we haven't actually got to the first shots being fired in the revolution yet. We're still gearing up for the beginning of the revolution in February. And so we thought it'd be appropriate this early in the year to look at the ideas that are out there that are flowing to and around Greece and Greeks, and laying in some sense the foundations for the events that would begin in late February and March of 1821. Now, I think no one will dispute that the obvious source of revolutionary ideas which are coming to Greece and Greek speakers at this time is the events of 1789 and the French Revolution. And for at least those of us who read Greek, we're all very much in the debt of Paskalis Kitromilidis, the author of this excellent study, republished in 2000, which charts the flow of ideas from the French Revolution into the Balkans, and particularly into Greece. We don't have anything quite like that in English, though of course increasingly scholars, and particularly our panelists, are beginning to look at different aspects of the migration of ideas. And indicatively, again, if I may, I'll just hold up another book for you to see on the screen. This is a broad survey that came out just less than a year ago, and sorry, I'm hiding the author's name, I didn't mean to do that, Revolutionary Europe, and at least in theory, this is addressing very much the question that we're addressing. I don't want to say anything about a book whose author is not able to be represented here, but it seemed to me that at least from the point of view of those of us working in the Greek area, this book shows that European ideas are very thoroughly interconnected, but no one, including this author, it seemed to me, has very convincingly connected Greece into that network of ideas. So this is where we, and particularly tonight's panelists, come in. So let me now introduce our three panelists in order, and I should explain, I'm not going to interrupt the flow of these migratory ideas. So once I've introduced all three of the speakers, we will move seamlessly from one speaker to the other in the order in which I've briefly now introduced them. So first of all, Ada Diala, bottom left on my screen, I'm not sure about how you're seeing it. Ada Diala is Associate Professor of European and Russian History in the Department of Theory and History of Art at the School of Fine Arts in Athens. She is the co-author with Alexis Iraklidis of a book called, in English, called Humanitarian Intervention in the Long 19th Century, Setting the Precedent. That was published in 2015. And Ada will speak on the revolutionary idea of human rights and the Greek 1821. Moving on from right to left on my screen, Effie Gazi is Associate Professor of Modern History in the Department of Social and Education Policy at the University of the Peloponnese. Her most recent book in Greece, which has just been published, is Unknown Land, Ideas About Greece and Europe at the Beginning of the 20th Century. And Effie will speak on Eleftheria y Thanatos, freedom or death, migrant ideas, travelling concepts, and changing political landscapes in the age of the Greek Revolution. And finally, Kostas Tambakis, with the aid of a PowerPoint presentation, he is an associate researcher at the Institute of Historical Research just down the road from the BSA, part of the National Hellenic Research Foundation in Athens. Kostas holds a PhD in the history of science from the University of Athens, and among his research interests is the cultural and social history of science in the modern Greek state. Surely, at least in my experience, a rather so far neglected area. Kostas will speak on, quote, a slight idea of physics, close quote, revolutionary ideas and the natural sciences before and after the founding of the Greek state. So I will now hand over to our panelists, beginning with Ada Diala.
Thank you, Professor. Good evening. Thank you, Professor, for your kind introduction. Thanks. I want to thank him for the invitation, the British School of Athens and the King's College. I also want to thank all of you who are here with us this afternoon. I'm sorry. When the Greek Revolution erupted, politicians, intellectuals, and public figures, all those who could speak, write, and comment on what was happening among the Orthodox Greeks of the Ottoman Empire, had no difficulty in associating the uprising with slavery and the insurgents as having been enslaved by the Sultan and thus victims of barbarities. From the first moment was set up in motion a vocabulary which was intended to evoke humanitarian sentiments. Words such as extermination, annihilation, effusion of blood, massacres, and slavery were in common use. All of them were connected to the idea of violation of human rights or natural rights, and traveled these words through the Philhellenic discourse, diplomatic documents, and the printed word from document to document, from lips to lips, from one journal to another. In what is to follow, I will try to historicize in the context of the Greek Revolution the notion of human rights, and its related concept of humanitarianism. These concepts were, among others, very much associated with the abolitionist discourse against the slave trade. My intention is to trace these ideas, which transcended state, imperial, and continental borders, from the years of the Congress of Vienna, 1814-1815. The Congress of Vienna did adopt a declaration of banning the slave trade. Abolitionists effectively mobilized public opinion and put pressure on the delegates to uphold humanitarian norms as motivation for their policies. In the aftermath of the Congress of Vienna, the discourse of enslavement, sklavia, concerning the condition of all Orthodox subjects of the Sultan was in use in order to delegitimize the sovereignty of Ottoman rule. The issue of enslavement linked with the idea of human rights, humanitarianism, and in that respect with the idea of a legitimate struggle of the Ottoman subjects against an illegitimate and barbarian sovereign. As we will see, the Russian delegation, comprised of the patriot and Polish nationalist Adam Czartoryski, as ex-Russian foreign policy minister and close friend to Tsar Alexander, the courtier patriot and second Russian foreign policy minister Ioannis Kapodistria, Alexander Stulze and others, Russian delegation was very active in establishing the vocabulary of humanitarianism regarding the policies towards the Ottoman Empire. And with this, I arrive at the next point, which I want to underline. Although all the big European empires set the stage for the movement and the border crossing of people, ideas, and objects, I will take as my vantage point the so-called Russian periphery. There are a lot of reasons to turn our attention to the Russian Empire. For my purposes, I will refer to two of them. First, the preparation for the Greek struggle for independence has taken place in part of Russian soil in this vast multicultural, multi-ethnic empire, a hybrid of traditional and modern components, where expatriate Balkan people, Greeks or Greek speakers, participated in Russian and international political, cultural, and economical networks. In these networks, people, discourses, and practices traveled in space and time in various directions, from west to east, from north to south, and the other way around, both influencing and being influenced by novel cultural trends. In my opinion, we have to consider the centrality of the Russian political intellectual factor for the Greek revolutionaries, which is complex cultural matrix, which consisted of a combination of the Enlightenment, the Romanticism, Christian Orthodox religiosity with roots in Byzantine culture, and the appeal also to the ancient Greek heritage. Unfortunately, in the general historiography on the human rights and humanitarianism, Russia is almost absent, except for the Soviet period and in connection to the anti-Soviet dissidents. This absence is due to the stereotype that this subject concerns liberal societies such as Britain and France. Nevertheless, since the 18th century, the notions of autonomous self was circulated in the Russian Empire. And from the time of Catherine II, there were various social venues in operation, such as lodges, theatres, saloons, and clubs, and of course, the press. Thus, the public space was not limited to the government, but moved beyond the more autonomous spheres that constituted public space. Second, in the Congress of Vienna, Russia asserted itself as a European power, not only in the political sphere, but also in cultural and philosophical terms. Before I proceed further, a clarification is in order. Most of those who study human rights and related concepts such as humanitarianism and humanitarian intervention do not agree that we can study them for a period before the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, 1948. Samuel Moyn, for example, differentiates between rights of men and human rights. In fact, he finds a distinction between them, and he finds that human rights indeed have revolutionary properties. The rights of man, on the other hand, were always connected with national projects and state politics and are civil rights. On the contrary, Lin Han insists on the usefulness of studying the history of rights. In her study, Inventing Human Rights, she argues that human rights were an invention of enlightenment. They gained currency in the 18th century because the idea of human rights was based on new experiences and social practices, which created a new emotional regime with imagined empathy at its center. The demand for human rights, when raised, could not be denied forever. Hunt insists that in the long term, the human rights discourse opened up a political space in which new rights could be asserted. The promise of those rights can be denied, suppressed, or just remain unfulfilled, but it does not die. Now let us turn our focus to the years prior to 1821 on the issue of abolitionism, humanitarianism, and the Balkans in the Congress of Vienna. The Congress of Vienna discussed extensively and regulated a number of issues regarding almost the whole of the European continent. Balkan questions were not included, even though the fate of the Ottoman Empire was bound to be a cause of destabilization and the threat to the perpetual peace envisaged in Vienna. Nevertheless, the Russian representatives to the Congress tried to put forward the case of the Ottoman Empire from within the Serbian question. The Serbs had taken up arms in 1804, and the Russian Emperor Alexander called for measures to be taken to prevent, in his words, Turkish massacres against them. In January 1815, the Serb representatives arrived in Vienna in the hope of persuading the great powers to intervene on their behalf vis-à-vis the Sublime Porte. In February of the same year, Alexander circulated upon the advice of Ioannis Kapodistrias a note and a memorandum on how to deal with the Serb issue. Alexander's intention was to convince the participating great powers in the Congress to take common action so as to prevent the Sublime Porte from manifestations of revenge toward the Serbs, for, as he put it, they are a major affront to the sentiment of humanity. His aim was to establish the right of the European powers to intervene in support of the Serbs against the Sublime Porte on the basis of three motives regarded as common to all Europeans: religion, the voice of nature, and the cry of humanity. Alexander's intention to gain a common declaration resembled the course followed by the abolitionists, and the language of the memorandum echoed the abolitionist discourse, which was based on humanitarian considerations and the shift from the early modern norm of protecting religious minorities from persecution to the notion of becoming involved for the reason of common humanity, basically European humanity, so as to stop the effusion of blood. This shift has occurred largely because of the efforts of the abolitionists against the transatlantic slave trade, which was very much active during the Congress. In this respect, it is mainly the abolition movement and not the protection of Christian minorities that constitutes the moment of the start of humanitarian policies and the idea of humanitarian intervention policy. In Vienna, abolitionists tried successfully to mobilize public opinion so as to influence the ongoing Congress to adopt a ban on the slave trade. And indeed, as I have already said, the Vienna Congress did adopt the declaration on banning the slave trade. Abolitionists, in order to achieve their aims, corresponded with intellectual and politicians, including Tsar Alexander. Famous British abolitionists such as William Wilberforce and Thomas Clarkson believed that the Russian Emperor was a sincere liberal and humanist and would support their cause. Indeed, the Russian delegation was a very active supporter of the abolitionists. 3 years later, when the question of the slave trade was discussed at the Aachen Congress on December 1818, Alexander argued forcefully for the need for a central mechanism that would ban the slave trade. His project has been drafted in a memorandum by Ioannis Kapodistrias. Apart from the diplomatic discourse, the same ideas as the Russian memorandum, which Alexander circulated among the participants of the Congress regarding the Serbs of the Ottoman Empire, were developed in the Russian press, often through translation from Britain, German, Italian, French, American, or other sources. Namely, that the Serbs, Greeks, etc., are not subjects of the Sultan, but tributaries. Second, they have no kinship with their oppressors and do not enjoy the privileges of and protection of the Muslim Ottoman subjects. Hence, they had the right to claim their freedom. And third, that it will be just for Russia or another powerful state with similar views to come to the assistance of the Orthodox subjects in their quest for liberation from the Turkish yoke. When the Greek Revolution erupted, many observers subscribed to the idea of humanitarianism and linked the slavery of the Negroes with the sklavia of the Greeks under the Ottomans. And they made the point that Europeans rightly seek justice against the slavery of the Negroes, and they have to do the same with the sentiments of humanity towards the Greeks. For example, some months after the eruption of the revolution, the Russian diplomat and senator Alexander Yakovlevich Bulgakov, an acquaintance of Ioannis Kapodistrias, wrote to his brother in Constantinople. Everyone talks about the uprising of the Greeks. Many things appear exaggerated and constructed. No one knows what will come out of this. However, it is a holy affair. I trust that we, the Russians, will not sacrifice the poor Greeks. This is not the story of Naples, but an uprising of a whole people that have been exploited. Even the Negroes have been supported by the powers. Are the Greeks worse than the Negroes? The argument of enslavement associated the Greeks with the black people and the colonial condition. This comparison was generally recognized as seen by comments on the part of Alexander Pushkin and by the future decibels. Also, Abbat Dominique de Pratt, in his Europe and America in 1821, associated the Greek case with those of Latin America and claimed that military situation does not make the Sultan the legitimated head of the enslaved Greeks and regards the Greeks and their fate as similar to that of the colonial people, such as the Negroes, Indians, and Mexicans. Let us now focus our attention to the Greek speakers themselves who were supportive of the revolution. Konstantinos Oikonomos was a central figure of the Greek-speaking Orthodox intellectual milieu, and he was a cleric of Greek origins who was attuned to the climate of the Neo-Hellenic Enlightenment, whose very early years were connected with Smyrna and Constantinople, and now he was part of a wide Russian net of intellectuals and diplomats. Oikonomos used the idea of anthropika dikaiomata, in his words, in order to justify the Greek Revolution. In the event of the burial of Patriarch Georgios V in Odessa, he argued that for the rights of the conqueror to be lawful, they should be based on the national and human rights, anthropika dikaiomata, of the conquered. To the extent that the Sultan state does not recognize another high authority than itself, it cannot be one with the civilized European nations, for it does not recognize human rights that are generally accepted in Europe. Obviously, Christian relation with the Sultan is more one of enslavement and not of common religion and nationality. What were these human rights for Oikonomos? They were security of life, security of property and trade, religious freedom, and honor. Oikonomos described the Ottoman Empire as an ancient regime defined by privilege and proposed a new one characterized by rights. In the place of subjects, he envisioned citizens loyal to the idea of a nation. The principle of legitimacy, namely the non-legitimacy of the Ottoman sovereignty on Greek Christian populations, referred to the violation of basic human rights, what decades later come to be known as the standard of civilization. Within this context, invoking human rights was a discourse against despotic and arbitrary rule. And on this ground, the revolutionaries and the various filaments, liberal or conservatives, invited the great powers to intervene on behalf of the insurgents. By way of conclusion, in 1821, the revolutionaries and the others who referred to these issues used the arguments of slavery to delegitimize the rule of the Sultan and to legitimize their own revolution. They claimed also that it complied by the wider spirit of the Vienna Congress. In this perspective, they insisted that their struggle was based on European principles. As we all know, the end of the 19th century was the epoch of the great debate regarding rights as regards peoples and not only individuals, hence the related novel principle of nationalities. However, these were hardly the rights for all, as has been the case from 1845 onwards, but left out women, slaves, children, prisoners, the sick or insane, and others. It is what Hanlin has called the paradoxes of human rights as politics. But as he insists, you know the meaning of human rights because you feel distressed when they are violated. As claimed by Kostas Douzinas, human rights have an emancipatory and revolutionary character when they come from the oppressed and are a weapon to transform the world, their world. Thank you for your attention.
I think you can start anytime you're ready.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. I would like to thank the organizers, the BSA and King's College for this very kind invitation and all participants in this event. I should not participate under false pretenses. I am not a historian of the Greek Revolution. I am very interested in the history of political ideas and concepts. Currently, I'm working on the history, on a project on the history of the idea of liberty. And I think that it is through this context that I crossed with the Greek Revolution in my work. So in my presentation today, I will briefly summarize certain important arguments from relevant literature, historical literature, and I will also share with you some preliminary thoughts on the history of the ideas of freedom and liberty in the revolutionary contexts of the late 18th and the early 19th centuries, with a focus on the Greek Revolution. Our understandings of freedom and liberty have changed over time. Although we tend to equate contemporary notions of rights and individual independence with these concepts, with these fascinating concepts, their origins and trajectories are interestingly diverse, while the ways they relate to politics, to governance, and the limits of legitimate power are exciting. Humanists and Renaissance scholars recaptured the idea of liberty as a set of legitimate norms of power, and the revolutionaries in the late 18th century in France and America became inspired by this idea and revolted in the name of liberty, defined with a variety of ways: individual freedom, liberty from oppression, but also as the liberty to govern themselves. Political struggles in the American and French revolutions involve these shifts in conceptualizations of freedom and liberty. Fight in the name of freedom, the predominance of discourses and visions of liberty and freedom also portray how revolutionaries and participants in the Greek War of Independence, but also the architects of the modern Greek state and its institutions, understood the ideas of liberty. Of course, the study of the genealogy of ideas is not attractive to historians these days, and I think rightly so. It has become more and more evident that tracking direct influence or a line of transfer is hazardous, if not irrelevant, for a history of meanings, adaptations, and conceptualizations. However, ideas do not spring in a vacuum. In the course of historical time, liberty has acquired many contingent meanings, but there are similarities in sources, recurrence of themes, rhetoric, even images, which invite to the exploration of its rich and tangled histories. As mentioned above, the revived tradition of ancient political liberty reached its apogee in the revolutions of the late 18th century. La liberté ou la mort is the motto of the French Revolution. This motto, like the similar Anglophone, live free or die, originates on the one hand in Greco-Roman antiquity, and on the other hand, in similar expressions used during the War of Independence in the United States, notably the famous tirade by Patrick Henry, the American attorney and politician who gave the famous speech, later known as "Give me liberty or give me death," in the Second Virginia Convention in 1775. Washington and Jefferson were both in attendance, as were five of the six Virginians who would later design the Declaration of Independence. Of course, I'm aware that what happened in the Second Virginia Convention has long been a subject of debate. Patrick Henry, historical debate, I mean. Patrick Henry spoke without notes, and no transcripts of his exact words have survived to today. The only known version of his remarks was reconstructed in the early 19th century by William Wirt, his biographer, who corresponded with several men that attended, individuals that attended the convention. According to this version, Henry began by stating his intention to speak forth my sentiments freely, I quote, before launching into an eloquent warning against the English crown. In the American context, the frequent association of the words death and liberty in Shakespeare's plays may have inspired Patrick Henry. Also, liberty or death as a motto appears in the tragedy Caton, a play written in 1712 by the English playwright and poet Joseph Addison for Cato the Younger. Cato was an opponent of Julius Caesar, defending the old republican freedoms. In the second scene of the play, Cato addresses the Senate by saying, "A day, an hour, I quote, of virtuous liberty is worth a whole eternity in bondage." And also in scene four, it is now a time to talk of oath, but change or conquest, liberty or death. It seems that the play became popular both in the context of the American Revolution, where it was either played or its emblematic phrases were used. Also, it was translated into French in 1784, some years before the French Revolution. And the French dramatist and man of letters, Louis Abel de Rohigny, employed the term in his plays in the 90s, presenting the fight of ancient Greeks and Persians. According to the French historian Michel Biard, La Liberté ou la Mort circulated soon in engravings, iconography, and several visual and material sources. In the Greek speaking, while it seems that liberty or death also circulated in the Latin American revolutionary contexts, particularly in Uruguay. In the Greek speaking pre-revolutionary and revolutionary contexts, the variety of liberty, the varieties of liberty and of death, and I should perhaps use them in plural, and the different trajectories of these concepts offer us the opportunity not only to explore revolutionary political languages, but also to follow the nuanced and complex meanings of critical concepts during the Age of Revolutions. In this vein, I will briefly make four points. My first point is that liberty from oppression stands at the core of Rigas Velestinlis's works. I will say that in Greek, καλύτερα μια ώρα σε ελεύθερη ζωή παρά 40 χρόνια σκλαβιά και φυλακή. I translate, better an hour of free life rather than 40 years of slavery and imprisonment. These are the verses 7 and 8 of Historios, the battle hymn written in 1797. And again in Greek, Όποιος συλλογάται ελεύθερα, συλλογάται καλά. In English, when someone thinks free, he thinks well. In his physikis apanthisma, his work in English, the translation would be Anthology of Physics, published in 1790, Rigas claims in his words. As I mentioned above, Joseph Addison's play and words are important in the ways Rigas conceptualized this relation between liberty and death. Also, the second phrase seems to be linked to a poem written in 1734 by the 18th century Swiss doctor and poet Albrecht von Haller. Wer frei darf denken, denket wohl. Rigas might not have read the poem, but it seems that he was aware of its multiple uses in the German lands. Moreover, Addison then was also, I think, appraised by Enlightenment French thinkers such as Voltaire, Diderot, and through this trajectory, it is highly likely that Rigas might have read him in French or German works rather than English works. He was more familiar with the French and German works. Both authors and their verses were popular among students' political clubs in the aftermath of the French Revolution. Recently, the historian journalist Dimitris Psaras has published a book, a work on Rigas, in which he summarizes previous literature, previous important historical literature on Rigas' Sebelestine list, but also introduces to new perspectives and arguments. He argues that Rigas was informed about the American revolutionary rhetoric either through the French translation of Addison's play, but also through albums and family registers, the German term Stamm is Stammbücher, diaries and collections of German university students in the late 18th century. In this way, they expressed the liberal mind. Amongst them, we should make special reference to one of Rigas' friends, the young student Dimitrios Nikolidis, born in Zitza in Epirus, who studied medicine in Stuttgart. He must have met the young Hegel and followed the same route and bitter death as Rigas. He was one of his companions. In parallel, the French presence in the Ionian Islands turned them into a laboratory of political ideas and languages in the years, particularly in the year 1797, 1799, and contributed to the diffusion of revolutionary ideas and concepts. I do not have the time to expand in this area, but I should definitely mention that in 1823, the Zakynthos-born poet Dionysios Solomos wrote the Hymn to Liberty within this specific context, ideological and political context. Hence, liberty from oppression and tyranny was one aspect of the ways the concept was conceptualized. In Ελληνική Νομαρχία, Λόγος περί Ελευθερίας, Hellenic Rule of Law, Discourse on Liberty, published by an anonymous pamphlet in 1806, liberty existed within the law and also through membership in a political community. Let me remind you that Ελληνική Νομαρχία is an anonymous, polysemic, and highly controversial text attributed to several authors, including Koraes himself, in a recent research. I think 2 years ago, the historian Kostas Lapas attributed the text to the Epirot merchant Anastasios Pachos, based in Livorno and Amsterdam. The author addresses the question to his readers. I just translate this in English. I quote, "What is liberty? In anarchy, my fellow Hellenes, only the most powerful are free. In monarchy, only one is free. In tyranny, none is free, while all are free when there is the rule of law." αλλά τι εστί ελευθερία, in page 4. In this context, the author opts for a regime which guarantees the rule of law in order to make everyone free and claims that a legal and efficient administration can guarantee people's freedom. Even his definition of homeland, that's quite interesting, I think, links to this conceptualization of homeland as the land of the free. I quote, I will read the Greek quotation. Πατρίς είναι μία λέξης, δια της οποίας όλοι κοινώς εννοούσι την γην, εις είναι γεννήθησαν, ή μόνον ελεύθεροι όμως δύναται να καταλάβωσι την μεγάλην αυτή σημασία, και δια τούτο η δούλια διαφόρος προφέρουσι τιούτον όνομα. I translate. Homeland is a word by which everyone means the land where they were born. Only the free can realize its importance. My second point is that conceptualizations of liberty as liberation from tyranny, but also as the rule of law for the free, which both appeared, as I mentioned, in the works of Rigas or in Ελληνική Νομαρχία, were also and particularly constructively integrated, reinterpreted, reconceptualized, primarily in the works of Adamantios Koraes. Following the spirit of the Interlock and the French Revolution, Koraes conceptualized liberty both as a process of liberation, but also as a way of governance within the law. As an additional element, I would say, in Koraes' conceptualization is the idea of education as a form of liberty from ignorance. And I refer here to a comprehensive form of civic education rather than general knowledge. Pascalis Kitromilidis argues, I quote, that Koraes insisted the nations should attain maturity through appropriate cultural preparation. In this vein, Koraes converged with the tenets of the ideologue, who held that the cultural and political condition of a society ran in close parallelism and had to conform with each other. Education should spread as widely as possible among the modern Greeks, who should by this means familiarize themselves through with the culture of the Enlightenment and with the classics of their ancient heritage and of quotation. In the late 18th century, Koraes initiated the publication of a series of influential pamphlets urging Greeks to rise up against their Ottoman oppressors, his Adelphiki Didaskalia, Fraternal Teaching in 1798, his Asma Polemisterion, Martial Song in 1800, Salpisma, and also Salpisma Polemisterion, Martial Battle in 1801. Koraes directed all his energies into raising the educational and cultural level of Greeks, and above all, into instilling in them an awareness of the heritage of ancient Greece. But his liberty was also a modern concept. Lycurgus's speech, Logos kata Leocratus, Speech Against Leocrates, was published with an introduction by Koraes in Paris in 1826. There is there, in the introduction written by Koraes, a fascinating scene in which two friends discuss a dream of one. In his dream, Marcos Votsaris, the infamous Suliot fighter who was killed in 1823, meets in the underworld with Benjamin Franklin, who was holding in his hands, I quote, the American Constitution written in golden letters and showed it to everyone with joy, end of quotation. In the dream, Koraes narrates, Botzaris, Franklin, and other historical figures discussed the international events and the prospect of Greeks gaining their liberty. And so the brave Votsaris and Franklin and their interlocutors said that the constitution of the English Americans, Anglo-Americani is the term, must be adopted by the Greeks if they wish to be even happier than their ancestors. Previously, Koraes had a brief correspondence, as we know, with Thomas Jefferson in 1823. This correspondence, is very evocative. They both understood education as a form of freedom, as I said, as a form of emancipation, an exit from ignorance. In many ways, Koraes' editions exemplified, coincided with this educational idea. Jefferson's contribution to the furthering of the cause of liberty and rights had been, I think, momentous. Of course, racial slavery remained a very central issue, a very thorny and controversial issue. Limiting and racializing the notions of freedom. But their conceptualizations of liberty surface in their correspondence. Jefferson offered perspectives to Koraes along with Jeremy Bentham, although I think Kitromilidis and other scholars claim that Bentham's writings on politics and legislation were not at the forefront of Koraes' interests. My third point is that in post-Napoleonic Europe, powers came together to secure the Vienna peace. Liberty came to the forefront and acquired new meanings related to political freedom and national independence in this post-revolutionary, post-Napoleonic times, but also it became related to various forms of struggle and resistance in the age of various also restorations, not only of kings, but also of ideas. Dreaming liberty primarily meant fighting against absolutism and tyranny. Liberty visionaries and fighters formed an anti-Holy Alliance community. The Society of Friends, the Filiki Eteria, after its inception, inscribed the slogan, liberty or death, in the new contexts of the preparation of the Greek War of Independence and in the course of looking for leadership, drawing upon its previous meanings, but also linking it with the secrecy and visionary perspectives of the circles of Carbonari and Freemasons. Part of the international mind of the period thinked around secrets or conspiracies. And it seems that this conspirational thinking also contributed to visions of liberty. Emmanuel Xanthos declares in his memoirs that he became familiar with the ideas of freedom when he joined the Freemasons in Santa Maura in Lefkas in August 1813 through Panagiotakis Karagiannis. Lodges in the Ionian Islands, of course, date much back in time in the late 18th century. But in this post-Napoleonic context, the imaginary and symbolic nuances of the slogan became more important as it worked within the circles of secrecy, hope, oaths, ties, and visions for the future. It is not accidental, I think, that the scholar Ioannis Philemon pointed out in his history of the Filiki Eteria that it was the Freemason symbols that cultivated the aura and the passion for liberty. This passion, which is a forceful political sentiment, played its own important role in visions of liberty in the years preceding the Greek Revolution. My fourth and last point is that not only liberty, but also death was reconceptualized in the revolutionary context. The historian Spyros Ploumidis has shown how death was relocated from the social and cultural milieu of local, professional, and religious communities to the revolutionary and national context. In the latter, death became part of the struggle for liberty, while its geographical location was not the village, the small town, or the province, but the homeland. Moreover, this geographical location of death gradually acquired an extended imaginary dimension. As the struggle for liberty was massive, so death in the revolutionary context was potentially collective. War and death broke the traditional barriers and the local identities of the Greeks and forged a new community in which death was collective, as I said, but also political. The deprivation of political freedom was therefore perceived not only as death, but also as insurrection, insurrected from death. General Makrigiannis, I think, put it succinctly in his memoirs, "O homeland, do bless all Greeks in general, that they were sacrificed for you to be resurrected." To conclude, Slogans and mottos are critical aspects of a political or revolutionary movement. By tracking Eleftheria in Thanatos, we can illustrate the geographical, political, and cultural complexity of these key concepts in the preparation and the course of the Greek Revolution. Of course, processes of redistribution of power played their own critical role in the course of the revolution. Yet, ideas not only circulated, but also nested in a variety of contexts. To my mind, Eleftheria and Thanatos are important concepts which are on the move, constantly in the process of translation in the age of revolutions. Although it is doubtful whether they have formed a common language for revolutionaries, I would say that through its migration, liberty has contributed to the construction of a common grammar, of common visions, of a common political imagery of revolutionary struggles in many parts of the world, including, of course, the Greek lands. Thank you for your attention.
So, I'm the final speaker. I will try to be on time. And I would like to start by thanking the organizers of this great initiative for inviting me to participate and everyone in the audience for being virtually here. This is the new here, apparently. My presentation is about the relationship between the revolutionary ideas and the natural sciences in the half century before and after the founding of the Greek state. I will first focus on the role that the natural sciences played in the years before the revolution of 1821, in the discussions of the scholars of the Greek Enlightenment, or the modern Greek Enlightenment, or the Neo-Hellenic Enlightenment, it has many names. Then I will briefly discuss the renegotiation of the revolutionary past by the emerging scientific community in the nascent Greek state of the mid to late 19th century. But before that, a brief note about terminological anachronisms. Natural sciences, as we understand them today, as a set of clearly defined disciplines, which are the province of university-trained experts and whose research is conducted in university and industry and state-sponsored labs and so on and so forth, are a product of the 19th century. The term scientist itself did not exist in the English language until the Master of Trinity College in Cambridge, William Weyhill, proposed it in 1834. Before that, there were several different ways of studying nature, which included natural philosophy, natural history, and many others, even alchemy. This is why in my own discipline, the history of science, there is this question being posed quite often, what is the history of science the history of? To avoid lengthy and awkward descriptions like the one I just made, for the rest of my presentation, when I discuss the natural sciences, I will be talking about the various ways of studying nature that were prevalent in the 18th century and which during the course of the 19th century, eventually coalesced into and were replaced by what we understand today as the scientific disciplines. In that respect, these natural sciences have had a long association with social and political revolutionary ideas. I'm not talking about the more popular but historically dubious cases of Galileo and the Inquisition or Darwin and evolution. I rather refer to more accurate examples such as Voltaire's and Emile de Chatelet's translation and use of Newtonian mechanics to shame their compatriots into accepting the emerging Enlightenment ideas. Voltaire did not have any burning desire or capacity to calculate the trajectories of comets, which Emile could and did, but was rather interested in showing that a new way of perceiving nature coincided with his own views on French polity and society. Another example is the German revolutions of 1848 to 49, in which many students and scholars of the natural sciences took an enthusiastic part. When this quieted down, the natural sciences became associated in conservative minds with dangerous materialism, an association which later came to Greece too. Finally, there is the example of the activities of the House of an American Activities Committee in the 50s and 60s in the USA, which questioned physicists not based on their political ideas, but because they favored radical scientific theories. In the eyes of the committee, this could lead to political radicalization. Some of these American scientists went on record proclaiming their faith and devotion to the laws of Newton, the laws of thermodynamics, and other fields of classical physics. So how were political revolution and the study of nature brought together in the years before the 1821 revolution in the work of the scholars of the modern Greek Enlightenment? Once again, I must clarify what I mean. Since it was initially proposed as a term by Dimaras many decades ago, what constitutes the movement of modern Greek Enlightenment has gone through various debates and renegotiations. I use the term, in my presentation at least, to describe a loose network of Orthodox Greek-speaking scholars active from the mid-18th century to the first decades of the 19th century, located within the Ottoman Empire and the various Greek-speaking Orthodox communities all over Europe and even in the Black Sea. These were people that often studied together, discussed and referenced each other, and wrote and published in the same venues. They were not a unified collective and did not necessarily share a common set of goals and ideals, but they tackled more or less similar themes. More importantly, their work was perceived as providing an intellectual milieu by some of the most active participants of the 1821 revolution. Some of the scholars did take an active part in the preparation of the revolution and its initial stages in person. While the modern Greek Enlightenment has in general received historiographical attention, the role of the natural sciences in this movement has been much less discussed. The first thing to consider is the explosion of printing activity in Greek concerning the natural sciences in the years from 1760 to 1820. More than 220 books were printed in subjects ranging from astronomy to chemistry. Of course, these names, titles, and taxonomy of the subjects did not correspond to our modern classifications, and they bear names as subjects pleasing to the philosophers, Taraskindis Philosophis του Βαρδάλαχου, or grammar of the philosophical sciences, and so on and so forth. Nevertheless, they were publications in times spanning several volumes, written explicitly for presenting developments in the natural sciences, and used either for teaching or for educating a general, literate and able to afford these books, public. Several scholars wrote such treatises, such as Evgenios Bulgaris, Nikiforos Theotokis, Konstantinos Koumas, Theophilos Chairis, and it's easy to recognize that these were not peripheral isolated scholars, but rather protagonists of the modern Greek Enlightenment, which in cases were arrested for their revolutionary practices and fought in some of the battles of the revolution themselves. Among these scholars, there were many who had a special interest and a working knowledge of the natural sciences, and whose books refer to very recent advances at the time in natural philosophy and natural history. However, to make my point very plainly, I will discuss two scholars of another kind, and it was very interesting that Efigazis just spoke about some of them. The first is Rigas Velestinlis. I do not think there is a need to present who he was and what role he played in the pre-revolutionary years. I do like, however, to highlight that one of his first books was the one that Effi just mentioned, The Physikis Apanthisma, published in 1790. It was actually published at the same year and for the same audience as the more widely known Scholio των Τελικάτων Εραστών. Rigas was not an active practitioner of the natural sciences, and nor did he ever engage in any relevant professional activities. His reason for publishing this book was fully in line with his revolutionary fervor. He wanted to lift the spirits of those he considered to be his own genos by bringing them in contact with modern philosophy. In his own words, any true patriot is sad seeing the desolate descendants of the glorious Aristotle and Plato totally ignorant of the idea of philosophy. As my goal is to help my nation, genos, and not to compile words, I had to present this material succinctly and with a simple language so that everyone can acquire a slight idea of the incomprehensible physics. This is where the title of my presentation comes from. This is the same reason that most of the scholars of the Greek Enlightenment give for dealing with the natural sciences. Not only those who had an active interest in it, like Koumas or Veniamin Levius, but actually most scholars believe that the new natural philosophy was an essential component of the Enlightenment idea, alongside the ideas of self-governance, polity, and social liberalism. They believe that superstition and ignorance was a political problem, and that the natural sciences was a means to address this problem. As for the sources, here we see the fresh ideas in renegotiation. Riga's book was a compilation of the encyclopedia, the French encyclopedia, the archetypical Enlightenment book. Rigas is explicitly following a French blueprint here in what and how he does what he does. A telling point about the political program this book belongs to, and this is something that Effie also mentioned, is that Riga's famous appropriation of Haller's dictum, he who thinks freely thinks well, first appears in this book. And it's important that it appears when this book discusses the Copernican Revolution. It is an open question why, or I'm trying to say that it's not actually an open question, why Rigas is putting this slogan here. Another pointer is the fact that the book offers a specific discussion of what natural phenomena can give the appearance of vampires or vrukolaki. This is, of course, a direct attempt to display and explain a very prevalent superstition with some not very convincing explanations about the spontaneous ignition of vapors and so on and so forth. The second scholar I will discuss is Adamantius Koraes. Again, I'm following Effie, apparently. Once more, I do not believe that the discussion of his importance for the modern Greek Enlightenment, for the revolution is necessary. Koraes had studied medicine and had translated books on medicine and the natural sciences, but had not written something like Velestinlis Physikis Apanthisma. Nevertheless, he had a specific task in mind for philosophy and for the natural sciences. As an example among many, in his Salpisma Polemisterion, which just got mentioned, writes that a nation great, majestic, brave and enlightened, the glorious friends, happy devotees of the wisdom of your ancestors, he's talking to his fellow countrymen, let's say, show to Europe what the love of freedom guided by wisdom can do. Here, freedom, knowledge and what we can call ancestral worship, more or less, come together both to praise the French and to motivate the reader counter revolution. And again, later on, because of the Turks, our common fatherland, patris is the word he uses, the fatherland of philosophers and heroes, has become today a den of barbarity and ignorance, amathia. It is necessary, Koraes says, in order to reclaim the glory of ancient Greece, to step out of this ignorance. In another text, found in the third volume of his collected Atacta, Koraes discusses the miracle of the holy light of Jerusalem. In his view, it is a false miracle first reported by Westerners in the 9th century and then taken up by unscrupulous Orthodox clergy to profit from their flock. It is in fact a superstition that needs to be addressed. Koraes would see the sciences and the arts take over. In his own words, consider what could happen if these alms and devotions that went to the Jerusalem clergy were used to open schools for the sciences and the arts. Another way to examine the connection between the natural sciences and the revolutionary ideas is to go the other way, so to speak, and see the reactions the new knowledge elicited. From 1797 onwards to 1802, and then again in 1819 and in 1821, Orthodox clergymen and the Ecumenical Patriarchate in Constantinople and Istanbul itself published several denunciations of the novel scientific ideas coming from abroad. It is not my intention to invoke a stale and very much obsolete science versus religion historical narrative. The reasons for these denunciations were far more complex than reactionary acts against Western novelties. My point is rather to underline that even for the opponents of revolutionary ideas, natural sciences were an integral part of their appeal. In this vein, we find Sergius Macreos, the teacher of philosophical courses in the Great School of the Nation, the Mechalogenes Scholi, publishing an incredibly backwards-looking pamphlet in 1879 to specifically denounce the Copernican cosmological model and its supporters from an Orthodox perspective. In 1802, Athanasios Parios, a leader of the Kolyvades movement, a renowned Orthodox scholar, an opponent of Koraes, who almost got excommunicated and the descendant of the Orthodox Church since 1995 currently, wrote a book called On the True Philosophy or Contradicting the Rational Fervor of the European Philosophers, and so on and so forth. Its title is self-explanatory, and it contains passages like the following. People should remember that the Holy Bible is the only true philosophy for a Christian, and those who are enlightened by its eternal nimbus should be pitied as blind and dark, since they are not taught by astronomers of what happens in the sky, but how to ascend in the sky. Finally, in 1819, the Ecumenical Patriarchate, under the leadership of Gregorius V, issued an encyclical which denounced the new scientific ideas as harmful and prohibiting their teaching in Orthodox schools. In fact, any book published in Greek in Constantinople and Istanbul had to first be approved by the Patriarchate, and especially by Ilarion Sinaitis, a high-ranking member of the clergy. The condemnation was repeated in 1821 and generalized, actually, just days after the revolution had started. In the age of the Orthodox Church, the institutional, official Orthodox Church, scientific ideas were part and parcel of the revolutionary ideas that were coming from the West and especially from France. As a final note, the relationship between the 1821 revolution and the natural sciences was recontextualized after the founding of the Greek state. The Bavarian Regency that accompanied the underage King Otto founded, among other institutions, the University of Athens and the Athens Polytechnic School in their original institution in 1837. These offered courses in the natural sciences and thus became the locus of a new kind of expert, the Greek natural scientist in the modern sense. The first such scientists had studied abroad and had to create a Greek scientific community ex nihilo, as well as defend a role for their expertise and consolidate the intellectual and cultural norms that would justify this community's existence. To do that, they harnessed the ideological resources that were already prevalent in Greek space. The legacy of the 1821 revolution was such a resource, alongside Greek language and the reclaiming of the ancient classical Greek glory. Thus, we see Iraklis Mitsopoulos, the first professor of natural history in the University of Athens, declaring in his inaugural speech in 1845 that the European nations came to our aid, to Greece's aid, during the 1821 revolution, because their debt to the science of the Greek ancestors obliged them to. Anastasios Christomanos, the founder of modern chemistry in Greece and the most influential Greek scientist of his time, said in his own inaugural lecture in 1864 that by the textbooks of Vulgaris, Theotokis, Balanos, Kapetanakis, Kumas, Iliades, and Vodelas were the natural sciences brought into Greece and became common resources of spiritual freedom and progress. As much gratitude as we owe to those liberators who bought our freedom with their blood, the same gratitude we owe to those men that raised our spirit through science and created the spirit of freedom and victory. This is a theme that comes up again and again during the 19th century. It is a part of a whole narrative, a whole discourse the first Greek scientists created, so that the natural sciences were not only part of the glorious and, of course, uninterrupted Greek lineage, but also played an important role in the 1821 revolution and could continue to play an important role in other national pursuits, such as the grand idea of national unification and the pursuit of intellectual and technological might like that Europe enjoyed. In doing so, they echoed many of the same arguments that we saw Koraes using, but that is perhaps something to be discussed at another time. So, to sum up, the natural sciences were harnessed as part of the ideological project of the modern Greek Enlightenment to help foster the revolutionary fervor of the Greek-speaking Orthodox population. This echoed directly the French Enlightenment and led to the natural sciences becoming part of the bundle of philosophical and political ideas and ideals which were the ideological milieu of the Greek Revolution. After the founding of the Greek state, the Greek scientists incorporated that legacy in their own defense of their community and expertise, as they did with other prevalent ideological norms of the time. And with that, I'd like to thank you and leave you with these pictures of the statues of Rigas Phereus, Adamantios Koraes, and Patriarch Gregory V, which are to be found outside the University of Athens in the center of Athens. Somehow, I believe that none of them could be happy with the company they keep in the afterlife. Thank you.
Well, thank you, a very warm thank you to all three of our panelists. And what a marvelous sort of interconnected panel triptych this really has been. I mean, starting off with Ada's presentation, really almost unexpectedly throwing the origin of some of these ideas of freedom to a place that in Western Europe, at least, is not traditionally associated with ideas of liberty at all, namely Tsarist Russia. And some fascinating insights about the role of the Russian delegation at the Congress of Vienna, and this very timely issue of slavery, which is discussed in different contexts, very much in our own time, actually taking back to some of the discourses of the 18 teens. From there, Effie explored this, the slogan or banner or the sort of watchword of the revolution, liberty or death, and teased out its multifarious connections, how the phrase had been used, had generated different meanings in different contexts. And I was particularly struck to, I don't think I myself entirely realized this, to what extent a slogan that, you know, we so easily associate with the rank and file and the Orthodox, you know, there's a religious war on the ground, liberty or death. It's almost interchangeable with orthodoxia e thanatos. You know, it's the Orthodox Church in a war of religion. But, and I just wonder how many of the people who actually, you know, cried out those words or fought under their banner quite realized, you know, how those words had previously been used in England, Germany, America, and Germany and France. And then Costas finally taking us into what I said at the beginning was for many of us perhaps slightly unfamiliar territory, and showing in a fascinating way how the secular ideas that we'd heard about from the first two presentations were integrally bound up with the revival and the development of secular scientific inquiry, first of all in the Greek Enlightenment. So that showed really the, I suppose the well, it illustrated in a different way, the well-known trajectory from the Greek Enlightenment absorbing ideas from the West and then feeding into the desire for freedom among Greeks themselves. But by drawing in the reaction, the negative reaction of the Orthodox Church and the correspondingly positive reaction of the secular state created by the Bavarian Regency and by Otto and his successors, it really showed how the revolution itself becomes a revolution not only in the ways we always think of it, but as being as part of the scientific revolution that is part in turn of the whole creation of modernity in the world as a whole that we associate with pretty much the same period. So, as I said, a very warm thank you to all speakers for their marvelous insights and for the intersection of these of their own ideas, which have kind of migrated together on our screens and in our sitting rooms as we sit and listen. And I think we can we have certainly some time left for some discussion. We will hear some views from listeners, viewers, as it were, out there. But I'd like to open the discussion really by asking the three panelists, are there questions from any or both of your fellow panelists that you would like to ask now before we open the floor to a wider discussion? Costas.
This is a question mostly for Effie, but I'm sure that Ada also has very fascinating insights on this. And I ask Effie because she very specifically made a point on this subject during her speech. It is about the circulation and the concept of knowledge on the move and the genealogy of ideas, which I found very interesting and very fruitful because it was very specifically stated. And I would like, because I know that her presentation was very much focused on this, and she generally has worked a lot on this, what is perhaps her take on this historiographical models where we try to see how things appear in one space and then appear in another. There have been several attempts to talk about circulation, but Effie Gazi spoke about nested appropriation, which I found very fascinating as a subject. Perhaps she can say a bit more on this.
Yes, thank you very much, Costa. May I?
Of course.
Professor Beaton, may? Yeah, thank you. As I said, in my presentation, very, very briefly, my point of departure in this research that doesn't focus on the Greek Revolution necessarily, but the Greek Revolution is an episode in a very complex history of the concept of liberty, is that we can actually think perhaps the 19th century or even earlier epochs outside the frame in which there is a specific center which generates ideas, and then these ideas are kind of, consumed by the others. And my perspective on this question would be that this kind of, this very thick variety of circulation of ideas means that they are somehow implemented, reconceptualized, adapted in various concepts. And this, the history of their trajectories is an important aspect of their quality, of their meanings. Unless you track their trajectories, you cannot actually realize how they even work in the center. For instance, let me just make a very brief comment. I find this introduction, Koraes' introduction in Logos Kata Leokratos, I find it a fascinating piece of text in which Voltaire discusses with Franklin, and they discuss the American Constitution and the concept of liberty. To me, this is an example, an emblematic example of how you can bring ideas and their actors and people and humans together outside the frame and the taxonomy and the hierarchy of the center and the periphery. And in Koraes' piece, you can actually come across this kind of, humans and ideas coming together and creating a space in which they acquire a new meaning. I find this absolutely fascinating.
And if I could just add to that, the other thing that, I mean, is fascinating about so many of Koraes' prefaces is the choice of ancient texts he chooses as a kind of pretext. And they,
exactly.
In that case, you've got Lycurgus writing in 330, isn't it, in Athens, at the very time when Alexander the Great is conquering the East. But this is all, it's sort of the democratic Athens against the monarchical Macedonians, whom, of course, Koraes didn't really regard as very much part of his Hellenic world either. So that the ancient context is a further dimension there. Any other? Ada, yes.
I largely agree with Effie on this issue on circulation and appropriation. And in Russian studies now, the most of researchers challenges the idea of the diffusion model, that exactly what Effie said, that there is a center, and from one center, ideas travel for the different directions. In my opinion, these ideas travel, and in every station, they are transformed. And I know that it is strange to connect liberalism and liberal ideas with Russia, but there were liberal ideas and liberals, and usually at that period they are connected with the future decemvirates. And I think that we have to understand and to to understand what liberalism meant at that time in different contexts, because liberalism is something very complex. There's a complex idea with very with main changes during the 19th century. So I am afraid that we have the idea of liberalism, the liberalism which was established in Europe after in the second part of the 19th century, and we don't understand properly what was liberalism in the first part of the 19th century.
Effie, did you want to reply to that?
No, actually, I have, if we have the time,
yeah, sure.
I have a very short question for Ada, that perhaps she could elaborate a little bit on the Decebrists. I'm curious about their perception of perhaps the Greek, not the revolution per se, but the Greek struggle or the Greek issue, if you would like to say, because I think that Russia is an important aspect, an important player in this, and there are several aspects in this question.
Yes, if I may. The future Decembrists, because when the Greek revolution was started, the Decembrists uprising did not exist. But this milieu of Russian officers who had liberal ideas and were friends, let's say that, with Alexios Psilandis and so on, they were supportive of the Greek Revolution, but they regarded the Greek projects as conservative because they were in their perception, too much on independence and not on the civil liberties, because their discourse of Greek revolutionaries was not, they did not elaborate the discourse on liberties, on civic liberties, and it was directed only towards the independence. So they, of course, supported this aspect, but they found that Greek revolutionaries were not so, how to say, radical as they perceived themselves.
I suppose Pushkin fits into that picture too, doesn't he? Because he was briefly quite enthusiastic at the very beginning of the revolution, but kind of seems rather to have lost interest.
Yes. Pushkin was very enthusiastic in the beginning, but after, like many Philhellenes, he was disappointed by the Greeks, which he could meet in Odessa, and he wrote very interesting things about this. And he also was disappointed with Ypsilantis, with Alexios Ypsilantis and his behavior in Moldavia. And after that, he wrote a very interesting piece, Kidzali, which is unfinished, but yeah. That is very interesting.
Well, thank you. Well, I mean, among the panel, I think you know, we've really got a bit of discussion going with a good momentum, which is excellent. If I may now, I'd like to turn to the what do we call you? The audience, the viewers, all you people out there, for whom we're most grateful to you for following this and coming up with your questions. So, just a selection of questions. The first one, I guess. Well, I'm. First one comes from John Kitmer, and he typed it at 5:35, so it's very patently, Ada, this is for you. Mm-hmm. John says, how did Russian intellectuals who believed in the 1810s, 1820s, that Greeks were slaves, how did they view the status of Russian serfs who were not emancipated until 1861?
There were some intellectuals that were against the serfdom in their country, and there are a lot of things that were written at that time by them. But also Alexander the First, in some point, was against serfdom, and also he abolished serfdom in Western provinces, the German provinces of his empire, and he elaborated a lot of projects for abolishing serfdom, but. There is a very complex story why this didn't continue and to be applied in other parts of the empire. But yes, of course, there was there were a lot of intellectuals who speak against serfdom from the point of view of nation and nationalism, because in order to be a nation, serfdom, slavery is out of the context. Well, so yes, even the conservative Alexander Sturza, who was a Phanariot, a Moldavian, but a Russian bureaucrat, he was against serfdom because of his Christian beliefs and nationalism. So it's very interesting, this question. Thank you.
thank you, Ada. A question, this one, I guess, is for Kostas, and it does seem rather topical in these days of embolias mors, of vaccination. Konstantin Buhayer asks, regarding native Ottoman Greek physicians active before the Greek Revolution, Timonis and Pilarinos were the first to apply vaccination scientifically against smallpox in the early 18th century. Considering that this discovery was applied to living persons in their part of the world, is it a confirmation of scientific research outside the influence of the Greek Orthodox Church in the build-up to 1821?
This is a very interesting topic, and it brings a very important subject on the fore, which is which exactly Orthodox Church are we talking about? There's this tendency to discuss the Orthodox Church as a monolithic organization with one mind and one viewpoint. And this is a misleading, let's say, historical image of the Orthodox Church. Many of the scholars of the Neo-Hellenic Enlightenment were themselves part of the clergy. And there were members of the clergy that had very provocative and, let's say, modernistic ideas before the Greek Revolution. So there was the part of the Ottoman Church that denounced the ideas coming from abroad, in which I mentioned actually, and there was in parallel a stream of thought that was introducing these ideas to the Greek Orthodox population, the Greek-speaking Orthodox population. The specific comment also brings another point, I think, to the fore, which is very interesting. The idea that Greece arose as a state and modernity happened to it, and before that there was nothing out there in the Greek-speaking regions at all. And I think, scientifically speaking, and I think that this way of looking on the intellectual production of the era is more, let's say, is obsolete now, and it has been renegotiated a lot by recent historical scholarship. So the Orthodox Church did not have a single viewpoint on scientific ideas, and scientific ideas, as they were considered at the time, were to be found in several centers of Greek-speaking Orthodox populations at the time.
Thank you. rather a long question from Yorgos Yanakopoulos, which is addressed primarily to Ada and Effie. I'll take this, I think, perhaps in two parts. The first, maybe this is for you, Effie. Whether you'd like to elaborate on the relation between the concept of liberty you discussed and liberalism as a political ideology in this period. Effie, would you?
Yes.
You comment on that?
I can just make a couple of points. I'm not sure I can cover this a very complex and very demanding area. Following from our previous discussion, the revolutionary Greek lands, particularly even during the revolution, were to me, and I find this very successful, a very, I think it's a good characterization, are coming from different directions, this is a laboratory of ideas. And I find it very important, the ways it works, even in the national assemblies. So when we talk about liberty or even liberalism, which is not the same thing as concepts of liberty, I would like to make this point that there is a variety of conceptualizations and there are various voices. This is a multivalent, a polyphonic period of time. For instance, if you take Koraes, Koraes was very much devoted, focused on the ideas of if you want political, an appropriate political organization, the role of justice, free speech, if you want all these kind of political concepts coming from the ideologue and the French Revolution. Others were even from, I would say, more radical in this perspective. Take, for instance, Vincenzo Gallina, who came to the Greek lands. He was a well-known Carbonaro, and he also he worked with the Greeks in the writing of several pamphlets, revolutionary discussed the constitution, and also I would say Anastasios Polyzoides, who actually wrote a lot and thought a lot about the American constitutions. So you have many voices coming from different perspectives. I would say Koraes was a very influential figure outside Greece and inside, of course, the Greek lands. And I would say that there were more kind of, you know, if you, I'm not sure about this taxonomy, but there is a more moderate, focused perspective coming from Koraes, but also other even more radical voices coming from other intellectuals, politicians, or people in the revolutionary field. And next to that, I would even say that there are all of these voices coming from another area that have to do with a way of more modernizing monarchies. This is in the post-revolution, post-Napoleonic years, the restoration of the Bourbons. This is kind of, you know, there are several thinking about if there is a way of saving monarchy from this kind of the revolutionary cares. And it seems that there are even these kind of perspectives. I don't know if they come from the Russian part, Kapodistria or that. I haven't looked at it, to be honest. Perhaps Adam knows more about this part. But there are also various varieties around a more conservative perception of what the state to be could actually be. And this is quite important. If you actually think that Greece had a constitution before it was even a state, a proper state.
Precisely, yes, indeed.
Which is absolutely fun. I think it's fantastic. And I think that it proves my point, actually, that this is a laboratory of political national ideas, that you come up with a variety of constitutions even before you actually have a state in the proper sense of the term, which is very voluntaristic, very, it shows your potential, and also kind of, you know, this, the vision and the dreams of liberty.
No, I think
perhaps we tend to forget that today because we don't live in revolutionary eras. People were very passionate about these ideas those days.
Absolutely. No, I think you're absolutely right about that, Effie. And of course, one of the ironies of the story of the Greek Revolution is that they lost that constitution as the price of getting their independence in the 1830s. Though you got it back in 1843. Probably the last question, but I'll extract this from the same questioner. It's for any one of the three. Historians of human rights, this is Yorgos Yannakopoulos asking, historians of human rights such as Eric Feitz argue, pointing to the Greek case, that the fight for the attribution of human rights to some almost always means the deprivation of human rights for others. and he talks about the Jews and the Muslims residing in Greece in 1821. I'm wondering about your thoughts on this, wondering whether any of the historical subjects you study were aware of this paradox. Would anyone like to, there's really two halves of that. Anyone like to jump in with that rather thorny question? Ada. Ada, you're muted.
Yes. Yes, human rights is a paradox, of course, because there are human rights for some people, and the same human rights are denied to other groups and so on. But we have to, if we had time, we had to discuss the various terms such as human rights, civic rights, and so on. It is different when we discuss human rights and natural rights and civic rights and so on. My point was more on the discourse on humanitarianism and in this connection with human rights as a vehicle for the revolutionaries and for the others to comment on what was happening in Ottoman Empire. And this humanitarianism, which was connected with intervention in a diplomatic discourse, was very important because this idea of human rights, humanitarianism, invented this humanitarian diplomacy. This is my idea. But of course, when the state was established, human rights was denied and the civic rights was denied, actually, to non-Christians and to Jews and Muslims and so on.
Costas, Effie, anything you want to say on rights? It's a tangled question, and I think it just shows that some of these ideas that were migrating 200 years ago, they're still migrating at a much higher velocity, really pinging around the globe, probably by Zoom and on social media, even as we speak. Well, I find this a fascinating discussion. I'm really grateful to all three of you, Ada, Effie, Costa, for your stimulating interventions, for taking the time in this difficult dark period to put together these presentations and to join us in this slightly frustrating medium of the virtual event, but we can't do it any other way, and it's been wonderful doing it this way. So thank you most warmly once again, and thanks also to everyone who's been watching and listening.